By the time we got to Apollo 13, this was our third lunar landing mission. The two prior missions had been pretty sporty. We were hoping for a change. This mission would go a lot smoother for us.
Hey, we had a problem here.
Say again, please.
Houston, we've had a problem.
There had been an explosion on board the spacecraft with a lot of collateral damage.
It was a classic case of crisis management. Good leadership throughout the organization fostered teamwork. And then there was initiative, thinking outside the box, perseverance. All these attributes turned an almost complete catastrophe into a successful recovery.
They finally found a gent who corrected my ear problem surgically, and after NASA looked at me for perhaps a year, decided that I was well enough to fly again. I was able to work out a deal where I could fly on the lunar mission. It was stretched out, instead of being 16 minutes, Freedom 7, it was stretched out to 10 days in Apollo 14, and they're obviously during the translunar and the trans-Earth phases, almost 3 days, when you really could relax. There were obviously tasks of navigation and unstowing and getting ready and so on that had to occur, but really relaxed, very pleasant moments.
Yeah, believe me, it's a lot harder to land a jet on an aircraft carrier than it is to land a limb on a moon. That's a piece of cake, that moon deal. Of course, the first feeling was one of accomplishment, I guess, if you will. Sense of realizing that, hey, not too long ago, I was grounded. Now I'm on the moon. But then that went away because we had a lot of work to do. After Ed had followed me down and we had set out some of our equipment, taken emergency samples, we had a few moments to look around. To look up in the black sky, a totally black sky, and seeing another planet, planet Earth.
You think it's pretty big when you're back there among your friends and it's 25,000 miles around and so on. But from that distance, you realize it is in fact fragile. It is in fact a small part only of our solar system, much less the rest of the universe. And I think all of us have expressed that. But to me, and I think to all of us, it was a realization that it is finite, it is small, it is fragile, and we need to start thinking about how to take care of it. At the end of the mission, I played with a little golf club, whacked a couple of golf balls up there.
Miles and miles and miles.
All of us wanted to try to think of something which would interest perhaps young people primarily, in the difference in the gravity. The gravity is only 1/6. The lack of atmosphere, there's absolutely a total vacuum up there.
Well, in my left hand I have a feather, in my right hand a hammer, and I'll drop the two of them here and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that?
How about that?
Proves that Mr. Galileo was correct in his findings.
Of the 6 landings on the moon, the last 3 I think were devoted completely to the science of it.
People like living and working on the moon because in 1/6 gravity, that pressure suit and I weighed 360 pounds, and you could jump straight up 1.5 meters off the ground. We had this rover that we developed.
The rover itself weighed over 1,200 pounds with a crew in there, but on the moon that's only 200 pounds. So the maximum speed of the rover was about 10 kilometers an hour. The thing that really saved us was that there was nobody coming from the other direction. You knew when you were up there, you're all by yourself, and it was exciting.
When we go back to the moon, people are going to really like to live and work up there because the environment is so enjoyable.
I was strolling on the moon one day in a merry, merry month of December. Now, May, when much to my surprise, a pair of bunny eyes.
You have to pinch yourself when you're on a moon. Am I really here at this point in time, in space? And the answer is yes, but it's almost like you're in the middle of some science fiction plot. When I left the moon and made those final steps, looked back down at my last footstep on the moon, and I'm not coming this way again. I couldn't stop the clock. and looked back at the Earth and came to the conclusion, you know, I don't know what it all means yet, but I've been lucky. I am not the last man to have walked on the moon, maybe the last man of Apollo, maybe the last man of the 20th century, but not the last person.
Our nation abandoned the moon in December 1972. Gene Cernan was the last human ever to walk on its surface. And for us, this was a marvelous time to live because we believed in this dream that we were given by John F. Kennedy. And we considered ourselves privileged and proud to be part of the brotherhood that formed in the early years of spaceflight. And we thanked our country every day that they gave us a chance to participate in this great adventure.
Of course, Apollo went on to take us to the moon, but it also left us with a tremendous technology to look towards the future. And as far as Skylab is concerned, it represents a definite turning point. We attempted to take a look at man as he reacted under long-term weightlessness. Whether or not we can extrapolate that 84 days out to several hundred days, incidentally, it takes something like 400 days for a typical Mars mission, we don't know right now. But it does indicate that we're on the right way to in assuming that man can exist for long times in zero G.
Right on the threshold of really a brand new opportunity to explore the solar system and the universe and to increase the value of benefits back here on home.
The fact of the matter is, if man stops really stretching himself and extending himself and looking out, then I think that's when civilization will begin to decline. Man just has that inquisitive nature, and it's got to be satisfied.
In the meanwhile, the Soviet Academy of Science, and I immediately talked to the head of NASA, and said, you know, hey, you've gone to the moon, but we've had this little space station. Why don't we get together some jointly? It was decided that the United States and the Soviet Union would do a joint Apollo-Soyuz, and I was chosen as the commander.
When we first flew into Moscow and they came to the United States, we'd all heard a lot of bad things about the other country. It was really almost instantaneous, though, getting together and understanding each other. We were in the same business. We were all dealing with spacecraft.
His granddaughter is named after my daughter. And my grandson's middle name is Alexei, named after him. You know, we're very close friends, very close. He's like a brother to me. We kept politics, all that, completely out of it.
Меня очень приятно удивило то, что американские астронавты оказались очень подготовленными людьми для космического полета. Ну, а если так шутку немножко чего удивило, то, что они у себя дома никогда не едят борщ.
Three, two, engine sequence start. One, zero, launch commit. We have a liftoff. All engines building up thrust. Moving out. Clear the tower.
Roger, tower clear.
Apollo Houston, I got two messages for you. Moscow is go for docking. Houston is go for docking. It's up to you guys. Have fun.
All righty, sounds good. Apollo Vino, Mila, Alexei.
Catania. Contact. We have succeeded. Everything is excellent.
I use an Apollo, I'm shaking hands now.
Apollo Soyuz was a great mission, and it opened up the Iron Curtain. It was the end of Apollo. It was a great, great era.
Glad to see you.
It is fantastic. It was very big symbolic. We conducted our program perfectly. It was only beginning of our future cooperation.
And so it was a demonstration to the whole world that two countries with different languages, different units of measurements, and certainly greatly different political systems could work together for a common goal.
And lift off.
Roger, roll, Endeavor.